Welcome back, guys. So in the previous video, we have discussed interpreters, in particular AST interpreters and bytecode interpreters. And today we'll talk about compilers. So let's start from the AOT compiler, which stands for ahead of time translation. And what is ahead of time? Well, this means before code execution, right? We fully translate the source code before execution. Okay, so this is our AST code, which we obtained in the previous lecture. And in case of the ahead of time compiler, this AST is passed at static time, that is at compile time, to the module which is called code generator. Now the code generator, after producing multiple intermediate representations, that is IRs, eventually produces the native code, right? In this case, as we see, it's x86 or x64, but it can be any target architecture, for example, ARM, WebAssembly, and others. Now, we should also say that compiler engineers tend to call as IR, that is intermediate representation, specifically the representations which come after the code generator, that is roughly after bytecode. And as we can see, there might be multiple intermediate representations, right? And for each of them, there might be its own code generator. And then this code is eventually passed to the CPU, which produces the final result. And this happens at runtime. So this was the ahead-of-time compiler. Now, when we talk about compilers, we also have back-end engineers and front-end engineers. And the front-end boundary is usually anything before the AST, right, including the AST. And the back-end is something after the code generator, right, multiple IRs, and finally the target code. And from this perspective, there is a project which is called LLVM, which stands for Low-Level Virtual Machine, which allows us reusing the existing backend. Let's see what it is. So here's again our parsed code. And using this LLVM backend allows us generating the native code for multiple architectures. Right, so if you want to have a cross-platform, cross-compiling code for x64, ARM, etc., you can use the LLVM, which will handle this automatically for you. And in case of LLVM, we need to produce specific LLVM bytecode, right? So pretty much similar as we had bytecode emitter. Here we have LLVM IR generator, which is nothing but bytecode emitter, but not arbitrary bytecode, instead specific LLVM bytecode, which is called LLVM IR. And once we have generated this LLVM IR, you can further pass it to the black box called LLVM, which fully abstracts its code generation. However, what is important here, as we said, that is able to produce multiple target source codes, right, for multiple platforms, and which again eventually is passed to the CPU and executed at runtime. Okay, let's take a look at the compilation example. We have this source C++ file, and as you can see, it's our expression from the previous lecture, x equals 15, and then we return x plus 10 minus 5. Now, to compile this code, I use standard Clang++ utility, which produces us this AOUT file. A stands for assembly and assembly output. And we can normally execute this generated binary file. And as we can see, it contains correct result. And if we introspect this file, we really see this binary code generated. And that is exactly the machine code. And we can obtain actually the source representation of this machine code if passed the dash s option. Now this produces us the source.s file, which is nothing but a assembly output for this program. And specific instructions here are here moving value 15, putting it into register EIX, and plus 10 minus 5. Again, the result is in the EIX. And the interesting thing here, if we pass the optimization option, we see that compiler was able to completely eliminate all the calculations and directly pre-evaluate the result 20, moving it directly into final register EIX. So that's the optimizing compiler. And this is nothing but calling interpreter at compilation stage, right? We call interpreter to pre-evaluate some expressions. And we have talked about LLVM, and Clang actually is able to produce specifically LLVM IR if we pass emit LLVM option, right? In this case, it produces this file source.ll, and this is exactly the LLVM IR. As we can see again, still the same instructions, moving 15, adding 10, and minus 5. So this is LLVM compiler. Now let's talk about JIT compiler. So the JIT stands for just in time. What is just in time? Well, this is at runtime. That is translating the code directly when the program is being executed. So at runtime assumes that there is actually some runtime already involved here. And in fact, when people talk about JIT compiler, they actually assume a virtual machine. Right, as we remember, a virtual machine, after obtaining this bytecode, is able to directly obtain the result, right, by interpreting this bytecode. However, imagine the situation when we have some heavyweight function, which does some complex calculation, and this function is called multiple times during the program execution. Right, so eventually, calling this function becomes a performance bottleneck. And what if instead of getting the output here directly, we obtain it indirectly? So instead of interpreting this function over and over again, what if we pause for a second and call the code generator directly at runtime? This code generator produces the native code, which is then passed directly to the CPU, and the CPU obtains the correct result. And once the CPU executed this compiled code, it can jump back to the interpreter, and the interpreter can proceed normally from there, right? Next time this function is called, we don't even compile this code at runtime. Instead, we use cached compiled version and have a jump directly to the CPU. And again, the purpose of the JIT compiler is to improve performance of the heavyweight operations. Although we should say there is a trade-off, in case if we have simple operations, it might be actually faster to just interpret them instead of calling the code generator, spending time on the compiling, setting the jump back. So you may consider this for specific optimizations when you have some hot path in the code and it makes sense to compile it to the native code. Okay, so that was the JIT compiler, that is translation at runtime. Now let's take a look at the final transformation pipeline, known as the AST-transformer. Now, the AST-transformer provides the high-level translation, and usually it's called Transpiler, right, from the transformer plus compiler. And the output of the AST-transformer is another AST. Right, let's take a look. So here is our parse code again, and in this case we pass it to the module, which is called AST-transformer, which obtains, as we said, the next representation, which is also just an AST. In this case it's AST-. Now, what is important here is that this AST might be of the same language or of the completely different language, right? For example, I can translate a new version of JavaScript to the old version of JavaScript, or we can translate, for example, Python to JavaScript, right? Obtaining completely different AST. And then this AST is passed again to the code generator, although to the high-level code generator, sometimes it's called printer, which prints the next representation, the high-level source in the different program. In this case, let's pretend we translated the Ruby code to the JavaScript code, right? As you can see, we added parentheses and the semicolon at the end. And so once we have this new source code, we can pass it to the black box called compiler, but it contains the full transformation cycle, starting from the tokens, from the parsers, ASTs, etc. And after eventual transformation, it will get the correct result. So again, this is the AST transformer, and as you can see, it's a pure front-end. It operates mainly at the AST. There is no access to the memory here, machine instruction, etc. And you fully rely on this black box compiler. You're hoping that there is some interpreter for this translated code. So we have been talking about interpreters and compilers, and this may raise interesting question. Is JavaScript or Python or C++ or whatever interpreted or compiled language? Well, in fact, this is a wrong question. What interpreted or compiled is not the languages, but instead implementations. Right, we can easily have a interpreter for C++, right? We can allocate a virtual heap in JavaScript and implement C++ semantic. Moreover, if we take, for example, optimizing compiler of C++, it is nothing but calling C++ interpreter during the compilation time. Right, so from one side it's a C++ compiler, but to do some pre-evaluation and optimizations, it needs to call interpreter for the same C++ language. What this means is, whatever you choose to implement your language, right, whether it will be AST interpreter, bytecode interpreter, or ahead of time compiler, doesn't really matter. What matters is the semantics, the final semantics, should be preserved. And from this perspective, it is actually a good idea when you design your language to implement first the AST interpreter, as a proof of concept whether your language is vital. And already after you have implemented full programming language at the AST level, you may go further and optimize, for example, the program storage and translate this AST to the bytecode. Once you have bytecode interpreter, it might make sense to add JIT compiler support, right? Again, for the heavyweight operations, which requires faster execution. And that's exactly the reason why we'll be using the AST interpreter in our class, since again, it's easier to explain the semantics of the programming language, and we'll be able to implement full semantic of a programming language. Okay, so at this step, we have reached the checkpoint for the part one. Let's do a quick recap. So as we know, there are interpreters and compilers, and what is interpreted and compiled are not the languages, but their implementations. We also know that compilers just translate from one language to another and don't execute any code. What actually executes the code is the interpreter, or the machine. We also know the concept of the abstract syntax tree, or the AST, and know about AST interpreters, as well as about AST transformers, or transpilers. We also have talked about ahead-of-time compilers, which fully translates to the target language before execution. And the JIT compilers, that is just-in-time compilation, which happens at runtime. We also said that bytecode interpreter, or the virtual machine, is usually an imitation of the real machine, and it optimizes for the program format, that is, plain array of bytecode instructions. And we also know that there is front-end and back-end of the compiler. Front-end is everything that goes until the AST level, and the back-end is usually after code generation, different IRs, bytecodes, and further the native code. Okay, at this step, we have a high-level understanding of the different compilation and interpretation pipelines, and this knowledge is enough for us to actually start building our language, and in the next lectures, we'll already start building the first parts of our interpreter, and we'll consider the simplest expressions. That's it for today. Thanks, and see you in the class.